such a success and continues to work day and night now in relation to making sure the consultation is also responded to. And on that note, the short point is, what we need is numbers. So it's great to see all of you here this evening, but each one of you needs to make sure that pretty much everybody you work with and pretty much everybody you don't work with, but that you know, responds to the consultation so that we have numbers. So that if, as we imagine, when the Lord Chancellor presses on anyway, we can say to him, hang on a minute, I think you might be being a bit irrational. So for tonight's purposes, Greg Powell is here, headlining in Camden, as we've said a few times this week. He's going to take us through the consultation. He's going to explain why it's a load of old rubbish, quite frankly. But more helpfully for you, he's going to tell you or help you with how you fill it in. What's really important is that we all say something slightly different and that each response is personal, so that the MOJ don't have the opportunity to say, this is just a bulk response, we're going to count it as one, rather than lots of individual ones. Steve Bird is then going to talk through the LCCSA response. That's going to go online tomorrow morning when it's finalised following tonight. And then Paul Harris is going to take you through the hub. Hopefully some of you have had the opportunity to have a look at that. It's a fairly straightforward online facility for you to respond to the consultation. In addition to that, also, I think it's published on some websites, but it's certainly going to be on ours tomorrow morning, is a guide to completing the consultation for people who are not solicitors or barristers or who are not in the criminal world, so that you can, as I say, ask all your friends and family to fill it in as well. And then there'll be an opportunity at the end, should we have enough time and should there be any, for questions generally to the panel, and we'll also be looking to the future and letting you know a bit about what else it is that we have been up to. Before I introduce Greg, please, just a quick plug to those of you who have kindly come along this evening that aren't members. If you could join up, you would be a member of an association, a dynamic association that is working pretty much 24 hours a day to save the criminal justice system, but also more importantly for you, the legal aid system and criminal solicitors working in the legal aid sphere. On top of that, you will have access to 16 CPD points, so all your CPD points each year by way of webinars. And then our fabulous advocate magazine, an ID card, and then we have the annual dinner and European conference. So there's forms for signing up. If anybody wants to join up, please do so. And then without further ado, please, I hand over to Greg, who's going to take us through the consultation.
The Ministry of Justice lost the judicial review, but from the consultation maybe you would never know this, and I think that they treat us with complete contempt. You have complete contempt in that they produce a short consultation paper accompanied by a wealth of documents on their website, and produce a document which has a very narrow focus, which the essential question of which is how many duties there is to contract should be let per area. The absolute necessity of a vast response is to make it clear that they cannot keep such a narrow focus, and that to do so in the light of the absence of evidence and the irrational nature of how they're proceeding would be unfair, and hopefully open themselves up again through judicial review. Now, you've all got a little handout from me, which is the series of slides. Quite small print. First of all, we're going to have a look at the slide called It's Politics, Not Money. Said to his lovely assistant. Just a few almost random examples. We suffer endlessly from the torture of being told that it's austerity and that £200 million must be saved and that £200 million constantly moves along. But here's just a few examples of things that go on today in The Guardian. There's a lovely little article about the fact that tax concessions and direct grants, so on, to corporations cost the taxpayer £85 billion a year. In that article, and I haven't had time to check it, but it seems extraordinary that the Department for Business spends on something called marketing, business coaching and advocacy £5 billion a year, three times the whole legal aid budget, civil and crime. The Ministry of Defence in 2013 overspent its budget by £6.5 billion. The NHS has cost £109 billion. And the total expenditure of the London Borough of Camden, in whose premises we stand, is £1 billion, roughly speaking, more than the whole criminal defence fund for the entire criminal justice system of England and Wales. So it's always ironic that we end up with the Minister of Justice telling us this can't be afforded, we have to cut, it's austerity, it's just politics. Now, what are the objectives of the Minister of Justice? These are taken from the front and the introduction of the document. They are, as you can see quite quickly, and you may think contradictory or paradoxical in a way in the midst of all of the cuts, that those who provide criminal legal aid services should continue to do so, so they don't envisage any reduction, it would seem, in the number of suppliers, that there should be necessary savings to the public purse, that there are assumptions made, and the key document in the consultation is a report by the accountants KPMG. Now, I can't really see very many of you because I have this enormously bright light shining in my eyes. But how many of you actually read the KPMG report? Hands up. That's only a small smattering. And you can keep your hand up if you understood it. Because it is the most obscure document that I've ever had to try and plow my way through. They also say that there should be a limited number of duty contracts which would deliver long-term and sustainable way forward, that this is not a consultation about anything other than the number of contracts that there should be, and that the market should remain competitive in future tendering rounds, which is 4 years' time. So these are very grand objectives. And what they want from legal aid practitioners and others with an interest in the criminal justice system is information and evidence to enable them to proceed, to decide how many contracts there should be. But hopefully we're going to give them a lot more information about why they should not be proceeding at all. And they also wanted specifically to comment on the Otterberg report, which is pages 5 to 8, which is his executive summary. So to recap, what happened was the Ministry for Justice had a consultation on contracting duty schemes. There were two reports commissioned, one from Mr. Otterburn, which was a survey essentially of 170 firms and their finances and their view about how they could proceed. And the KPMG report was also commissioned, but they failed to consult on those documents, which is why the JR was successful and why we're back here now. So for a quick look at the Otterburn reports, Nicola, if you would, to the next slide. Otterburn report, pages 5 to 8. Yeah. Right. This is very important because there's quite a good contradiction between what the Ministry of Justice have adopted as the parameters, if you like, of what firms should be financially, and Otterburn, because Otterburn said some things which they've chosen to ignore. So Otterburn said that, roughly speaking, there was a 5% average net profit margin for firms that they looked at, and that this was lower for larger firms. This is quite important because there's quite a lot of information that there is no true economy of scale. That firms had already reduced overheads, that the supplier base was fragile, cuts would have a disproportionate effect in London and the South East, that fee reduction should not take place before consolidation, although how consolidation is ever achieved. Most difficult question, that actually in London contracts should be about 1.1 million, but that's for police station, magistrates court and Crown Court litigation, to be a viable practice. Good small firms may end up getting excluded, and large suppliers may have to contract, because as you know, the scheme is that in any particular area, it's to be divided in equal amounts. So in a contract area like Brent, there might be 9 suppliers, they will get 1/9 of the work. If you're a large supplier in that area, you may already have more than 1/9 of the work. The MOJ should take a different approach in rural areas, management skills are limited, find that there are financial constraints to growth, and few firms would survive the loss of duty work. And that's important because it's the MOJ objective that all firms should continue to exist so there's still client choice and that there should be stability for the future and that there should be competitive tension in 4 years' time. And if the number of firms shrinks drastically, then you've lost your so-called competitive tension in 4 years' time. So moving on. Quick look at the number of providers, nice little graph. The larger blue are the civil providers, who you can see are shrinking drastically. The decline in criminal providers is slower but steady. Let's have a little look at criminal and legal aid spend. You can see from 2007-08, we go from 1.15 billion through to 2013-14 down to 0.9 billion. So we're really rapidly reducing spend. And the next slide is the public purse. There's been a 23.4% reduction since 2009. No one knows the target spend. I wanted to have a slide here. I was thinking of the back of Whirlwood Scrubs where the football pitches are, having the goalposts shrouded in fog, because that's kind of how the Minister of Justice's target is in relation to what should be the final spend. What is the target that you're aiming for? And if it is, as we think, somewhere around 865 million, well, you're already incredibly close to it with falling volume and cuts still taking effect. Do you really need to do anything further to get to where you want to be? And I think the answer is probably not. Now, there are lots of assumptions, and the first assumption we're going to look at is work volumes remain constant at 2012-13 levels. So the KPMG report, although it is heavily caveated, in fact, if you read it carefully, assumed for the purposes of their financial modelling as to how a duty scheme contract would work, that volumes would remain constant. Now this is an incredibly important question, because as revenue declines, if volume declines, and you have a very small profit margin, the amount of risk that you're taking grows. And we'll move on to here. Now this is hot off the Criminal Contract Consultative Group press. It's a very interesting chart. It's one which will fill you full of horror and no doubt reflect your individual experiences, because it's a chart about the standard monthly payment across England and Wales, how many millions get spent. And at the bottom line, you can see 2009-10. And the total on the right-hand side is almost 460 million. The top line, 2013-14, is pretty much an average of 30 million per month. You'll see some 60 million pound figures. That's because they put 2 months together. And so we're down to 12 times 30, 360 million. So over 100 million has disappeared in those 4 or 5 years. And that reflects the other figures that we have been looking at. So move on to the next. And here are some volume figures. Now the 2014 figures show a downward trend in relation to investigation work, down to 720,000 cases, extrapolating forward. So we don't have constant volume at 2012-2013 levels, which is an assumption which underpins the methodology supporting the contract process. And the next, and there's a nice little graph to show how the trends are going. And police station attendances, you can barely see it in relation to the beginning of this year. It's mirroring the red line, but it's well below the blue line, which was 2014. Very difficult to predict, that's the point, of what volumes will be. So we're being asked to enter a system and contracting a system where there is no guarantee of volume, and there will be quite a lot of fluctuation. The huge dip is always Christmas. I don't know whether that's because all the lawyers have gone on holiday, or the policemen have gone on holiday, or the criminals have gone on holiday. Probably a combination of all three. But we'd be pleased to know that once the holiday's over, everyone gets back to work and there's a peak in January. So, moving on. Now, magistrates' court representation. This is particularly alarming. So you can see there that 14-15, the early figures, it's always come with a qualification that all the data may not yet have been collected, but it's April and May, and we're now in October, so you would think even those of us who find the identifiable line in the corner of the room that we fail to be able to ponder whether we can or not. There are not too many of those these days, but it looks as if there is a very substantial decline in volume. And the next slide. Again, in number terms, post-charge, you can see how that's been going. So 432,000 maybe looks like a projected figure. Look at the figure that used to be in 2010-11, 582,000. So we have this huge continuous slide. So if you had to pick a trend, if you had to say on the evidence, does it, what's the better assumption? That the figures will be stable or that the figures will fall? All of the evidence points to the idea that the figures will fall, not that they will be stable. In the next slide. Complicated slide. The little bit of text says it's a bit of a mixed picture in the Crown Court. There was a large historical decline, but it seems to have picked up a little bit in recent times. And I proffer two explanations. One is maybe some VHCC work moving into ordinary Crown Court work. And we all wish we had those rare VHCC cases. And possibly the magistrates, as ever, thinking that the powers of punishment are not sufficient and declining jurisdiction when they might have accepted jurisdiction, because I can't imagine too many of us have clients who elect anymore, so in those small cases. And that's possibly a good guess. Now, this is a complete aside. The Lord Chief Justice, I went to hear him talk at a justice meeting, where he thought that actually the way forward was to get rid of big chunks of the adversarial system, have judge-led tribunals, particularly in fraud, remove the right of trial for small value dishonesty, don't know what he means by small, and possibly reintroduce the middle tier court, the old AULD report, which lies buried somewhere in the historical past of having some intermediary court between the Crown Court and the Magistrates Court. So judicial thinking in this manner is not exactly sympathetic to us in that they probably recognize. He was recognizing the constraints of austerity and basically, I think, moving towards the idea that not only juries should be abolished, but probably defense lawyers too. It's a slightly cynical view of the Lord Chief Justice. And moving on, and here we have the quote of the year. KPMG, following discussions. I'd like to stop there, because I like those discussions. I'd like to have been at those discussions. Because what I think those discussions were about is MOJ officials and the KPMG accountants scratching their heads, trying to find assumptions to make in their financial modeling, which would make the model work. You will know how this works, working your way backwards. You've all been in the Court of Appeal. You've all seen Court of Appeal judges doing it. They know the result they want, they just have to work their way backwards to get it. And this was something very similar, I think. And I think the Law Society, who are a rather different beast these days, I think, under the presidency of Andrew Kaplan, in their draft, in their response, going to ask for the information that is in the background of the relationship between the MOJ and KPMG. So continuing on, following discussions with the MOJ and the Law Society, and based on an expert knowledge of the behaviour of markets, made a number of modelling assumptions as to how providers would be likely to behave in the future. And I'd like to focus on the idea that KPMG had expert knowledge when we move onwards to the next slide. This is there just to hurt your head. For those of you who have actually read the KPMG report, there are many pages like this. And I've spent some hours looking at them. I can't say that I had an intellectually light bulb moment when I did. But it's all to do with that little chart at the bottom. It's all to do with measuring some kind of equal division of a contract across a procurement area, looking at the current suppliers, which are the little toolbars in the graph, working out how many could already meet the contract requirement, how many suppliers you actually want, and therefore how much scaling up there has to be in the market in order to be able to get to that number of desired suppliers having equal shares to meet the volume that there is. But it's very hard work. And the point about it is, the Ministry of Justice released this report to us and asked you all individually, would you like to comment on the KPMG report? And what you'd like to say, I think, is actually what I'd like my professional bodies to do, is commission an alternative KPMG to actually go through its assumptions and probably rubbish it, but it's tricky stuff. Moving on to the next slide, please. There's another one, I just threw that in just for punishment, really. You can look at that in a small print just for added torture later. So moving on to the next one. Okay, so this is the first assumption by those people in the MOJ and KPMG, the expert knowledge of our market. And the assumption, which no one here will think makes any sense whatsoever, is that providers would, on average, be prepared to give up to 50% of their own client work in order to meet the larger duty provider contract volumes. This is an assumption of the financial modelling that is being done. If ever there was anything that told you that the model is broken before it starts, it's this assumption, because no one here in their right minds is going to give up their own client work for the benefit of fulfilling their contractual obligation. And just think about it in practice for a moment. By what mechanism do you give up 50% of your own client work? So client A comes, okay, I'll call them by numbers. I'll take all the even number clients. So client one, I'm not taking you. Client two, I take you. Client three, you're out. Client four, you're in. I give you numbers like Sainsbury's or one of those little things. There's no mechanism by which you can give up 50% of your own client work. Or you maybe do it for a few months and then get to a point where you're not taking any new work. What happens to choice? This is supposed to be a system where the Ministry of Justice have retreated on the issue of choice. They've still allowed clients choice. Well, I want to come to your firm. No, I can't deal with you anymore because I've given up 50% of my own client work. Well, that's okay. So what becomes of that client? Okay, I'll ask for the duty solicitor. Is that you? Actually, it is. That's okay. No, it's not me. It's the other guy down the road. I don't want him. Yeah, but you want the duty solicitor. So whatever. And in the long term, this is a four-year contract. So you can do a four-year contract as a duty supplier. And what are you going to do at the end of that? Actually, I've bid again and I've lost. Oh my God, I haven't got any client work left because I've been sending them all away all these years. It doesn't make any sense to anybody. So that's the first complete nonsense. And it makes a nonsense of the expert knowledge of the market. But I'm not skillful enough as an accountant to be able to quite unpick the KPMG report. But I have a gut feeling as a criminal lawyer that it's a stitch-up. It's a fix. It's kind of been put together. together in order to find the end result that was wanted. And the other aspect of giving up 50% is to do with market consolidation. So they need to have firms who have enough capacity to fulfill the market for the given number of suppliers. So they take the total volume of work, divide it by the number of suppliers you've chosen. Each firm has to have that capacity. If you notionally take away 50% of their own client work, then they have more capacity. So then it becomes easier to have a number of firms who will then be able to fulfill the contractual obligations and take their shares of the market. So it's a device for saying that market consolidation is easier, because they've also set themselves a parameter that you don't want to have more than 25 or 30% market consolidation. So it's just a trick, essentially, to get to an end result. And here is assumption three. This is also a fantastic thing from a business point of view, that positive profitability would be sufficient to ensure viability for providers, even at 0.1%. So forget Otterburn's 5%, which the Ministry of Justice reject as not having any evidential basis being necessary. Any kind of profitability would be sufficient. In the papers that are on the website with the consultation is another document which appeared as a result of the judicial review, which is a report of the MOJ Commission from a firm called PA Consulting. It's worth a read. It contains contradictory evidence to the MOJ's plans, which is why they buried it, and which said that an 8.75% cut in fees would reduce firms on average to a 1.6% margin. Presumably, if there's a second 8.75% cut, they go into losses. But again, it reflects the fact this is a very fragile market, very low margins, can't deal with falling volume, and it's a very high-risk strategy to find yourself contracted in that market and being unable to reach the targets that you require by revenue, because there's less work to do. Stephen Bird is going to talk to you about the LCCSA response, and I have to say he has devoted many hours to writing it, and it's a really excellent document. And I steal from him a bit of his own research that KPMG themselves had a 13.9% profit margin in their last report. So I don't think they really think that businesses can proceed on the basis of barely being profitable. And in fact, they do quite heavily caveat their report to the MOJ. And a lot of the stuff asked by the Law Society is to do with, well, there are all these qualifications to the KPMG report. What did you do about them inside the MOJ? The next assumption, these are all assumptions which are in the financial modeling upon which the contracting scheme is based. This is called latent capacity. It is not a reference to the brain power of the Minister of Justice, because he is not thought to have any latent capacity. He's already at full capacity. And then sadly, that appears to be rather insufficient. So, another assumption is that firms generally have 15% latent capacity because there has been falling volumes of work, so they must have staff sitting around not doing very much. But of course, all of this is subject to a timeline, because it may be that when these reports are written in January and KPMG had 5 months to do this report, no doubt with a huge team, and I'd like somebody, if no one's done it yet, to have a freedom of information request as to what this cost. But in the time that has gone by, given the margins, the cuts, the falling volumes, many, many firms will have reacted to that and try to adjust their capacity to what they actually have. So the idea that there is 15% latent capacity in existence is a very large step to take in logic, and yet another one of the assumptions they built into the model to make it work. And the next slide, please. Yes, assumption five. Providers have capacity for 20% organic growth through recruitment. It's a nice little terminology. Organic means that you continue to grow in the same shape that you are, like becoming a bigger watermelon or something. And inorganic growth is their idea for the fact that you crash into another firm and you merge. But organic growth, so you've got a basis of being able to grow by 20% on average. This comes back also to an issue of resources. Do you have the resources to think to yourself, okay, I'm going to make these bids, I'm going to get these contracts, and I'm going to grow by 20%. So I'll take on new staff by recruitment. They recommend all the people who can't get jobs are pouring out of the law schools. Presumably they might want them on 0 hours contracts, but who knows? Or you've got to get them through accreditation and various other, teach them actually how to do the work. And you've done that, and then you find actually the volumes of work aren't there because they've continued to fall. So what kind of recipe for disaster is it that you should, if you were capable of organic growth and you make all that investment, you then find that the revenue is not there. So it's a very high risk strategy. And why there's always risk in this contract and this process is because there's no guarantee. This is not a contract where the Ministry of Justice say, whatever happens, we appreciate you taking on this share of this local market, and we guarantee to you X pounds because we believe that volumes are certain, but actually if they're not, if they don't come about, we'll compensate you for it. And that's not in the contract. So you're taking this huge chance, that, in particular in relation to volume. And the next slide. So number six. Now, this is where all our brains begin to hurt, not just mine. But a threshold for market consolidation of 25% is reasonable, and that there would be four new entrants per area in London. So their model has the idea that in every bid area there will be four new entrants, and that you only have to, as it were, wipe up 25% of existing capacity to be able to have a system that works. I'm still not entirely clear how this process is supposed to work. If you find my explanation incorrect, or you would like to argue about it, I'd rather not do that this evening. I'll arrange a special seminar where we all look at the KPMG report together with usually a woman, no gender bias intended, who has a crystal ball, and we can try and kind of work it out amongst ourselves. This is the tricky part of it, moving on quickly before. Okay, so getting along here towards the consultation questions. Now there's only six questions in this only 11-page document, so they want to have a very narrow focus. Do you have any comments on the findings of the Otterburn report, including the observations set out at pages 5-8? Now, there's a bit of homework in that, if you really want to do it properly. You can go to the Otterburn report. It's the executive summary, it's pages 5-8. I've kind of narrowed down those 3 or 4 pages of findings into that little slide that you have earlier. But by and large, we would like to adopt the Otterburn report. We think that it has more truth in it than the KPMG report in terms of its profit margin, in terms of the fragile market, the lack of resources, the difficulty of scaling up, and so on. Do you have any comments on the assumptions adopted by KPMG? Well, the answer is lots, right? Because you've been through this session, okay? So those assumptions are not tenable. Do you have any comments on the analysis? Same thing. Do you have any views on the MOJ comments set out in this document? Well, probably you can go back and read the document. For their own comments, but their own comments are they love KPMG's assumptions, haven't done any of the work they suggested, and reject Otterburn in summary. And if the assumptions and data remain appropriate, do you consider there's any reason not to accept the maximum number of contracts? Well, the short answer to all of this is going to be, this is far too risky to the criminal justice system for you to proceed. But let's move
conclusions. Any rational evidence-based risk cost-benefit analysis would conclude that the scheme would not meet its objectives. So let's go back to the beginning, where the Ministry of Justice set itself objectives. That all firms will continue in business. Well, quite large numbers of firms aren't going to have a duty contract under the scheme and they're going to go out of business. And actually the firms with duty contracts may go out of business because of the assumptions made about volume and because of continuing cuts. That there will be long-term stability. There's not even going to be short-term stability. There's going to be long-term chaos. There will be sufficient firms for future competition. Probably the most unlikely outcome of all in 4 years' time. There'll be lots of losers, according to the MOJ, who will have stayed in business on own client work, and who will then re-enter the market to provide competitive tension in 4 years' time. It seems incredibly fanciful. I did my own little gloss here. The KPMG assumptions are not based on our reality, and I have asked my professional body to commission an independent report to better inform me and the MOJ before a scheme which carries huge risks is implemented. So there's a kind of strategic position. We should all be saying to the MOJ, stop. Not in the name of love, but in the name of rationality. And we probably all do need, and either that's the Law Society or our professional bodies, something to be discussed, no doubt, someone to take an expert hatchet to the KPMG report. And I should be telling you this. Should these be the attitudes that you adopt when you write your responses? I will not surrender any own client work. They say they believe substantial numbers of people will, up to 50%, if they have 2,000 replies that tell them, I'm not going to surrender any. It becomes untenable for them to continue to advance a model or a scheme based on a model in which people are going to surrender substantial amounts of own client work. I do not have any latent capacity. I think that's probably true of most firms. I doubt that many firms who are continuing in business have people sitting idle. What you try to do is adjust your staff to the volume of work that you have. I do not have a basis to organically grow, given low margins and cuts. So I doubt there's many owners who think to themselves, well, actually, I'm going to invest in substantial numbers of new staff in the hope that this produces more profit, given I've got such low margins and there's further cuts coming. I do not have staff to redeploy. One of the MOJ suggestions is that firms should get a contract and redeploy the staff they have. Which staff would those be exactly? The ones doing profitable work? Are those the ones you're going to take and redeploy to the really unprofitable legal aid work? Most firms do not have people that they're able to redeploy. And finally, the most contentious little thing that I threw in like a cat trapped in a bag. Finally, the risks and costs are so high if the scheme proceeds, I will not bid. Because they do rely upon us all being willing as ever to cut our own throats and our neighbours' throats simultaneously in entering into the scheme and bidding. Highly contentious, very difficult, with those issues of trust, solidarity, our moment of greatest weakness when we're actually asked to do something. But the scheme would be undermined if very substantial numbers of people did not bid. At least at this stage, we can say we don't bid. You can go and bid a bidding when it comes around, but you can tell them you're not going to bid, at least as a like terms. Yeah, halfway position, perhaps. So that's a little, fairly swift, I have to say, resume through the MOJ consultation. It is very important that everyone responds individually to those questions. You can use your own experience of your own firms and the evidence you have to hand about people who've been made redundant, people who've accepted wage cuts, people who've left voluntarily to go and retrain, left the business altogether just through sheer depression, and to show that you can't redeploy people, you've got no latent capacity, you're not going to give up the certainty of own client work, and basically their model, which is based on those assumptions, doesn't work, and they really ought to stop before they proceed. And fundamentally because of the very big question, that they don't need to do this, because their budget is well under control, they're heading for that target figure, slightly shrouded in fog, whatever it is, and they really don't need to add this on. And what does this represent? I haven't dealt with the actual scheme itself, but in London in particular, and this is my kind of Ed Miliband moment really, because I actually forgot to do a slide about London. You've heard this from me many times, and those who have had the misfortune to hear me before. London, a vast rural area that is full of people, essentially, because it has all the problems of a rural area. It has also an unplanned criminal justice system. There is nothing near anything else, no prison near a court, no court near a police station, no magistrate's court near a crown court, by and large. It's all over the place, and your clients get scattered all over the place. And this gives us all the problems of a rural area, all the travel and all the waiting, which is essentially unrewarded, because we have lost track of the fact that we have enormous amounts of time which is unpaid. We also have, as businesses operating in London, very high business rates. Thank you, the London Borough, one of the ways the London Borough of Camden has its £1 million budget. I often feel I'm paying for a substantial portion of that myself as my offices in Camden. They have very high rents. You have very high staff costs because people find it very difficult to live in London, as we all know, because of the cost of living in London. And what isn't in any of these documents, and is never in any of these documents, and is never referred to, is the drum that the LCCSA has been beating for a decade, which is that there is another partial, possibly good solution to the entire problem of the so-called oversubscribed duty schemes, which is to limit every duty solicitor to two schemes or three schemes, which are the most, the ones they choose, which is the scheme where their office is, and maybe one or two nearby, just as the court schemes are limited, so the 24-hour schemes are limited. This would have the effect of localising the work, giving you more local volume, and be a much saner solution economically. Because what you don't have with that is the enormous cost. And I still can't quite get my head around the scheme that they are proposing. The idea that I might bid in my own area, and then bid in three or four other areas, maybe up to seven, and that I can bid both as myself, and I can bid with partners, maybe one or two, and I need probably at least six or seven different, maybe a multiplicity of those business plans, if bid A succeeds, and if bid A succeeds with bid B, and if bid A and B and C will succeed together, which is my business plan, and so on. And if everyone ends up doing that across London, it reminds me of those of you who are old enough to remember the original VHCC debacle, where we all bid and the Legal Services Commission ended up with over 1 million or 10 million, whatever it was, pieces of paper. It's a kind of insanity. It's a sort of, if you had to sit down and try and work out the most complicated, difficult, impossible scheme that you could possibly were imagining, let's all sit and do that in a room together with lots of drink and alcohol and other drugs, whatever. And you might end up with this scheme, because it is just some kind of bureaucratic insanity. So that old LCCSA proposition, let's limit everybody, let's make it work more local, never appears anywhere, never referred to, and perhaps some of us might refer to it again in the vague hope that somebody ever reads our responses. So thank you very much.
I could possibly say. I've spent about two or three days doing this response, and it's rather complicated. Now, we want everybody to respond themselves, individually and firms. Paul is going to tell you about the hub that's been developed by the CLSA and the LCCSA in a minute. But what we're trying to do is to make it as simple as possible for people to respond. The LCCSA response is I hope it's relatively concise. It's about 27 pages long, so it will be online tomorrow, I think. And I would recommend that before you put your responses in, You spend about an hour and 2 minutes a page going through that document. A lot of it is slightly repetitive in places, but that's really the nature of the consultation documents, I think. The consultation itself is said to be about the reports, the KPMG report and the Oxford report, rather than whether the scheme should be taking effect in the first place. Now, we tended to ignore that and give them our views on the scheme in any event and the difficulties that there are. If you remember back to the PCT consultation back in April 2013, that was a consultation on how PCT was going to be brought in. And yeah, there were 16,000 responses saying why it couldn't be brought in, and they didn't bring it in. The reports are complex. You've seen a couple of examples from the KPMG reports. I have spent quite a lot of time trying to get my head around these reports, and you know, really, it is the sort of thing that you need an expert to look at. Our response is liberally peppered with references to needing the time to get an expert to look at this and provide us with some expert assistance. The CLSA and the LCCSA have already written to the Ministry of Justice requesting further time so that we can instruct an expert and also an executable version of their model. Both of those requests have been refused. So we're sort of maybe totting up the judicial review points for the next round. It would be helpful, I think, as Greg mentioned, that in as many as possible of your reports, you make it known how difficult you find the document itself, particularly the KPMG report. Otterburn is a little bit easier to read, but KPMG is a complete nightmare. And as Greg mentioned, suggest that, you know, this is the sort of thing that really needs some kind of expert input. Okay, now, I started off going through the introduction to the consultation and making a few points about that. They start by saying that the proposals will deliver the necessary savings to the public purse, while ensuring that all those accused of crime will continue to have access to justice and receive quality legal representation. The defendants will be free to choose their lawyer, whether they want a big firm, their local high street solicitor, or a particular specialist, and that all those who provide criminal legal aid services could continue to do so, provided they meet minimum quality standards. Now, that statement is just wrong in so many ways when you look at what they're actually proposing. He's pretty much stolen everything I'm going to say, but Greg's already mentioned about the fact that most firms, according to Otterburn in particular, most firms are unlikely to be able to survive too long without a duty contract. In order to get a duty contract, most firms, again, are going to have to be very much larger than they are at the moment. As an example, if I were to apply, if my firm were to apply for a duty contract in 7 police station schemes that we're currently on, and assuming that we don't give up any of our own client work, we would have to employ another 50 solicitors. We currently have 22, so that's a huge increase in the size of the firm. Obviously, the figures come down a bit if you decide that you would only be bidding for a couple of contracts. But it's recognised by Otterburn that most firms, as he said, and I'm going to quote this, he said, most firms consider that the loss of a duty contract would be terminal. And based on the figures they provided, it appeared that most would make a loss on contracts within the first year. So if there's a loss on contracts, on client contracts in the first year, not too many firms are going to be there in 4 years' time. Not too many firms are going to be there very much after a year. So the choice that the client has is going to be narrowed down to those firms who have a duty contract fairly quickly, assuming that those firms with a duty contract have the capacity to pick up all the own client work, which will now be duty work, from those firms that have gone out of business in the meantime. and that they can continue to provide the services under the new, even further reduced rates. So it's not likely that defendants will be free to choose their lawyer after very much longer. It's not likely that they will have the choice of a local high street solicitor or a particular specialist, but they probably will have the Hobson's choice of a larger firm. The Ministry of Justice said that it had received advice from Otterburn and KPMG and concluded that there should be 525 duty contracts. Indeed, they did receive advice from Otterburn, but they tended to ignore pretty much everything that he said. You'll see when we get to the questions in the consultation document that one of them relates to what you think about the Otterburn conclusion in pages 5 to 8. And just to run through a few of those, you'll be able to see that we pretty much agree with everything that Otterburn says. He says that, that very few firms would sustain the overall reduction in fees set out in the Next Step document, and that was also a view expressed by PA Consulting in the report that they did, which we didn't see, and it was never disclosed to us. It has now been disclosed, but only because it came out during the judicial review proceedings that had been commissioned by the MOJ. And that's a report that's worth reading because it pretty much says everything that we've been saying for quite a long time. Otterburn said that most firms were dependent on duty contracts for generating new work, and few would be sustainable without it in the medium term. That any fee reduction should not take place immediately, but should be delayed to allow time for market consolidation. You'll remember that the fee cut came in immediately in March, the first fee cut. Few firms would be able to invest in the structural changes needed for a larger duty contract, and to recruit new fee earners. Now remember that when you're looking at the assumption that we can increase by 20% organically, that Greg was mentioning towards the end of his talk. He also said that the dual contract approach should not be adopted in rural areas where circumstances were different and the market was already consolidating and there was insufficient volume of work there to allow firms to generate the necessary efficiencies. Few firms, as he said, so he's already mentioned that, few firms could survive in a medium term without a duty provided contract. The main assumptions in KPMG didn't actually come from Otterburn at all, they come from the MOJ themselves. Specifically, the assumptions that firms had a latent capacity of 15% could grow organically by 20%, would give up 50% of their own client work, and would be viable at any level of profit. None of that came from Otterburn. Otterburn told us that most firms at the moment, well, the average profit margin was about 5%, smaller in larger firms, and that in order to remain viable, firms really needed a profit margin of a minimum of 5%. PA Consulting also said that if there were an 8.75% cut, as we've already had, that's expected to reduce the firm's median margins to 1.6%, and many firms at that rate would consider it not worth staying in the market. So they knew that before the first cut. So moving on to the consultation questions. First question is, do you have any comments on the finding of the Otterburn report, including the observations set out on pages 5 to 8 of this report? And please provide evidence to support your views. Well, it's slightly ironic that they should ask for evidence to support our views when they're providing none to support theirs. Otterburn's research is the evidence, really, and it supports us. It doesn't support the MOJ views. Now, just going through these the comments that Otterburn made in pages 5 to 8, one of the first ones is reduce the levels of work. Now, Otterburn pointed out that the level of work in the criminal justice system has been reducing. We know that's true. We, the LCCSA, along with the Law Society and the CLSA, asked Oxford Economics to do a report on this some time ago now. And that report predicted that the spend would not be on a flat line, but it would be going down as it had done for the last 5 or 6 years, and that fall alone would save £84 million from the government by 2018-19. So they'd be £84 million better off than their own predictions on a flat line basis. They're not the only people to say that the trend is downwards. The Legal Aid Agency, their figures in their most recent annual report show exactly the same thing. The Crown Prosecution Service, in their magically entitled improvement plan, published in March 2013, also shows a continued decrease in cases across the magistrates and the Crown Court. So the reduction in volume of work is something that's set out by Otterburn, that's supported by Oxford Economics, by the Legal Aid Agency, by the Crown Prosecution Service, and by pretty much everyone working in the criminal defence profession. So we agree with that. The next thing that Otterburn says is that on average firms were achieving a 5% profit margin, but larger firms had lower margins, and the full effects of the previous fee cuts have not been reflected in the figures. Again, we agree with that, and you shouldn't be saying so. This is evidence, this is as a result of his research. That shows that fee cuts of 8.75% that we've already had are going to cut profit margin perhaps more drastically than PA Consulting were even saying. The finances of many criminal firms are fragile. We don't have loads of money in the bank. We don't have lots of capital to increase the size of the firm. That's another finding from Otterburn, another one that we agree with, and another thing that's been ignored by the MOJ. Otterburn, although this is perhaps a bit too late, he said that if the first reduction in fees of 8.75% takes place before there has been any opportunity for the market to consolidate, participants indicated their profitability would be significantly weakened before they managed to secure additional volume. Again, we agree with that. We're all struggling with the 8.75% cut now. It hasn't obviously fit fully into our figures and won't do for a few months yet, I would imagine. Again, Otterburn saying most firms are dependent on duty contracts for generating fresh work. It wouldn't be sustainable in the medium term without it. That's another thing that we agree with, and we should be saying so. A 5% profit margin is a minimum definition of a viable practice. This is really important because, as you've seen from what Greg said earlier on, KPMG have used an assumption that any level of profit means that the firm is viable. Now, it's been said that would be 0.1%. It doesn't even need to be that high. It's any level of profit. I can't imagine how any business would, industry would think that was a viable practice. How can you possibly get by on 0.1% profit? You have a turnover of £2 billion. That's £2,000 profit at the end of the year. And your business is viable at that kind of rate. It's just a nonsense. Otterburn says it's a nonsense. Otterburn gives us that figure of 5%. The MOJ have decided to ignore that. It's not entirely clear why they ignored it, apart from one comment in the consultation document that says that there was no evidence to support it, apart from the fact that Otterburn has not dragged that figure out of the air, unlike KPMG. So they prefer the view of KPMG, if indeed it is the view of KPMG rather than the MOJ in the first place, that any level of profit would be viable. I'm just going to move on because we don't want to take too much time on this. Question two, do you have any comments on the assumptions adopted by KPMG and provide evidence for your views? Now, this is what Mr. Justice Burnett said in the judicial review. fact that the assumptions, other than on the flow of criminal work into the system, amounting to an uncertain judgmental prediction of future behaviour of those likely to be most directly affected by the decisions, would, to my mind, tend to suggest not only that those very people should be asked, but also any resulting decision would be better informed if they were. But we are the people that are most directly affected. This is partly why we won the judicial review, because we haven't been asked about these assumptions, and now we are being asked. And the judge says that any resulting decision will be better informed if we're asked. Well, it will be better informed if we're asked and if we're listened to. Now's our opportunity to put forward what we want to say about these assumptions in the hope that we might actually be listened to. So what are the assumptions? Future work levels are predicted on a flat line. Well, I've dealt with that already. That's what the MOJ are doing. It's contrary to what's happening. It's contrary to what everybody else seems to think, including the legal aid agency. It's an assumption. What's quite difficult often to work out with these is, you know, if the assumption is wrong, what would the outcome be at the end of the model? And without a version of the model that we can put the figures into, we can't necessarily tell that. But one would imagine that if the volume of work is falling, then the contracts, you probably need fewer contracts in an area and therefore bigger firms. The second assumption, solicitors are saying a duty contract would give up 50% of their own client work. Well, I struggle to think of anything particular to say about that particular assumption. I mean, Greg dealt with it. It's probably the most controversial assumption. We understand that it came about by the Ministry of Justice saying that we'd all give up all of our own client work if we had a duty contract, and the Law Society saying no, we wouldn't give up any. The Ministry of Justice saying, well, okay, well, we'll take 50% then. They don't seem that seems to be how it happened. And it's as simple as that, and as mad as that. You're just not going to give up your clients, and you should say so. As Greg pointed out, if you're a firm that gets a duty contract, and over the next 4 years, you systematically drop half of your own client base, if you don't get a contract in the next round, there's ever a next round, there's enough people around to make their next round, all of your own client work's disappeared. It's all gone. It's just simply not a way to run a business. It doesn't make economic sense, it doesn't make business sense. And we're not going to do it. You know, goodwill is the lifeblood of all of our firms. It's what we compete on. It's what we're all about, really. And you know, we're not going to give up our own clients. We're simply not. So let's tell the MOJ that we're not going to do that. The next assumption is the one about profitability and viability, and I've addressed that already. 15% latent capacity in any firm. We don't have 15% latent capacity, not as far as I know. Maybe other people in the firm might tell me otherwise. But I suspect most of you haven't got that kind of capacity floating around your office. We know that the volumes have been falling over time. Firms have adapted to meet the volume that they have. We can't afford to have people sitting around doing nothing. You need to tell the Ministry of Justice in this response whether your firm does have 15% latent capacity, whether you can increase the workload of your staff by that level, and it's quite a lot, 15%. Organic growth of 20% has been assumed to be achievable through increased recruitment activity. Now, Otterburn, if you remember, says that that we're all financially very fragile. We don't have the money sitting around to recruit other theaters. If you get a duty contract, and if we're right about what happens with own client firms, there'll be plenty of redundant solicitors around to possibly employ. But as a firm seeking to get by on the rates of pay that they'll be paying you, I don't think you'll be looking to recruit qualified solicitors. You'll be looking to recruit paralegals. And one of the most irritating, not actually a strong enough word, comment in the KPMG report says this, that there is potentially a pool of untapped capability that could reduce salary costs. For example, 38% of College of Law graduates in 2010 were unable to get training contracts, albeit the majority of these managed to gain law-related work as a paralegal. So the suggestion is that those who are not good enough to get a training contract in any other area of work that pays better can work as a paralegal for a criminal legal aid firm. That's actually in the KPMG report. That's what they think of us. So let's tell them what we think of them. There'll be two or four new entrants to the market. Two everywhere apart from London, because two doesn't work with their model in London, so it has to be four. Don't ask me why. I have read the report about 15 times and I can't really work it out. But it's, as Greg says, it seems to be working from one end and trying to get the answer that you want. But it's difficult to see how there could be any new entrants to the market as duty contract providers because of the size that you'd have to be to get a contract. Difficult to see certain new firms coming in. Maybe merged firms would be considered to be new entrants to the market or consortia. But then if you're thinking about a consortium arrangement with other firms, think about the added administrative burden that that brings. The idea, as I understand it, behind this is that there will be a consolidation of the number of firms, so there will be fewer and bigger firms doing duty work, and that will bring about economies of scale, so we're told. But if you are going to join together with other firms as a loose consortium, then you don't have any economies of scale. You've still got your office and office of firm B and firm C, you've still got all the staff. And you'll be doing the work at the lower rates without the economies of scale. What you will have are diseconomies of administration, because somebody is going to have to administer how you split all this up between the three firms that are involved, because the LAA will only contract with one of you, and the others will be called delivery partners. And they won't be having any money directly from the legal aid agency under the contract. So you know, it's an administrative nightmare to think how that would actually work in practice. It's something to think about when firms are considering whether they should be joining other firms, either as a merger or more likely as a sort of a loose arrangement. Third question. Do you have any comments on the analysis produced by KPMG? Well, apart from saying I don't really understand it, it's difficult to see what else we can say. We made a few observations in the response. The report is so heavily disclaimed by KPMG at the start that you never instruct an expert. Them as an expert, if they were putting that kind of disclaimer on the evidence, they would have invited you in case. What they say is that we've satisfied ourselves as far as possible that the information presented in our report is consistent with other information which was made available to us in the course of our work in accordance with the terms of our contract and scope as agreed with you as the MOJ. We have not, however, sought to establish the reliability of the sources by reference to other evidence. So they haven't considered the reliability of these assumptions that they're making based on what the MOJ has told them. And then they go on to say in rather cryptic terms, this engagement is not an assurance engagement, conducted in accordance with any generally accepted assurance standards, and consequently no assurance opinion is expressed. I haven't got a clue what that means. As I say, it's not entirely clear what this disclaimer means. I don't know whether that's a common disclaimer in reports given to government. It does look like KPMG haven't tested anything at all. They've just taken it as read. And I asked the question there, what's an assurance engagement? What's an assurance opinion? What are the generally accepted assurance standards? So So KPMG seems to be saying, don't blame us if it all goes wrong. We're working on what you told us. And it's particularly frightening when you consider what Mr. Justice Burnett said in the judicial review. He said that the impact upon those who secure the contracts and upon access to justice, if the assumptions underlying the KPMG calculations are wrong, would also be serious. Consequences for the access to justice are extremely serious if they've got this wrong, and they have got it wrong. A London issue that we've raised in this response relates to potential for multiple bids across different duty areas. This is something, obviously, that we're used to in London. We will act in up to, I think it's probably up to seven different duty areas for police station work. It's not so common out in the provinces or in other urban areas, but in London it's fairly common. Now, it's not clear how KPMG, or it's not clear if KPMG are taking into account that firms are likely to bid, assuming firms do bid, they're likely to bid in more than one area. And they seem to have worked on the basis that the contract's going to go to the largest firms in the area, and that those firms would have to scale up by a certain percentage in order to meet that, that requirement, capacity requirement. Now, what they haven't really taken into account, we don't think, is what if firm A is also one of the bigger firms in area two. So they've been in area one, they need to scale up by 25% or whatever to get that contract. But they've also been in area two, and they've got to scale up by 25% to get that contract. And they've been in area three, where they're also one of the bigger firms, and they've got to scale up by 25% to get that contract. So, you know, have they looked at each of these areas individually and thought that that model works, that's okay, it's only 25% to scale up, or have they actually looked across what would happen if people bid in different areas? And we don't think they have, we don't think they've considered that. And if they haven't considered that, then the model is completely flawed and it cannot work. Do you have any views, fourth question, do you have any views on the MOJ comments set out in this document? I wasn't entirely sure what they meant by that either, which document, which comment. I think they're talking about the current consultation document, and if they are, then we've dealt with that in the comments that we made on the introduction. That's the only place in the consultation document where they've expressed any kind of views at all. And then question five is my favourite, I think. If the assumptions and data on which the KPMG recommendations are based remain appropriate, do you consider there is any reason not to accept the maximum number of contracts possible, 525, as the MOJ have done? So they're basically saying, if KPMG are right, is it right? They're wrong. What can we say in answer to that question? They're wrong. The assumptions are not appropriate. They never have been. And to plough on regardless will be reckless. Final question is, do you have any other views we should consider when deciding on the number of contracts? Yes, we do. I sort of went into one here, I think, on this last section. The reforms are, I think, pretty dangerous, actually. They're dangerous to access to justice. They're disastrous for the criminal justice system as a whole. They're disastrous for us as criminal defence solicitors. They're untested. They're based on seriously erroneous assumptions. That makes the model itself completely unreliable. Any decisions, I believe, that are taken based on this model are liable to fail. Grayling is putting his neck perhaps on the block with this if he goes ahead with it. But we don't really care about his reputation if he has one. We don't care about what happens to him, but he's going to destroy hundreds of small and medium-sized businesses. And there is no justification for it. I've set out in a rather depressing table there what the rates of pay have been since 1996 of Crown Court work. So these are the rates that we're still working on for your confiscation type cases, for for Court of Appeal cases and for your special prep in Crown Court cases. And just look across at preparation attendance for an A grade. In 1996, we were paid £55.75. If that were index linked to 2014, it would be worth £91.32. Now, we're being paid £50.87. So, we're being paid marginally above half the rate that we were paid 18 years ago, once that's adjusted for inflation. We know that the spend is falling every year. We know that when the first consultation was launched in April 2013, Grayling said he wanted to save £220 million from the 2011/12 budget by 2018-19. The spend in 2011-12 was £1.08 billion, criminal legal aid only. He wanted to reduce that by £220 million, so we all sum, and we come to a figure of £860 million, which should be his target for 2018-19 for the criminal spend. Now, subsequently, when he was so generous as to provide us with proper payment for those cases which are elected in the Magistrates' Court to go to the Crown Court, which the Crown then throw the towel in, we're now being paid as we were previously, rather than the £2.50 that was on offer before that. That is £5 million back into the pot, so they want to save £215 million, which brings that ultimate budget up to £865 million. He's never acknowledged that figure. The MOJ have never acknowledged that figure. It's a simple question that's never been asked. What's your budget for 2018-19? We can only work on the calculations from the first consultation document. But he's never actually asked that. He's never answered that. He's not answered it because he wants to move the goalposts. He wants to be able to take savings that have already been made and bank them and make more savings. What's happened to the budget since 2011-12? Well, it's dropped. It's dropped by £172 million in 2 years. And that's without the cuts from March of 2014. That's the figure that we're at for the financial year ending in March 2014. £908 million, that's the cost of criminal legal aid in the last financial year. So he needs another 43 million quid to get to his target. So does he need to do any of this when we've got falling volumes? We've got an 8.75% cut that's already been made. Does he need to do any of this? Of course he doesn't. It's political. It's not about the money. And we should tell him that we know that. Thank you.
To the hub. Paul's going to come up on stage and give us an interactive demonstration.
Good evening, everyone. I hope you're having a good time. It's Wednesday evening, about 7:45, and here we are, a group of committed criminal legal aid lawyers living the dream. This isn't really what we want to be doing, but this is the position that we've been forced to be in, and I'm now going to very briefly take you through the hub. As I'm probably the least computer techie person in the room, I can't decide whether I've been asked to give this presentation in order to make a fool of myself, or alternatively, to show you that if I can do this, anyone can. So, a huge amount of work has gone into this from Robin Murray of the CLSA and Jim Mayer. It's taken many hours, but basically, this helps people respond to the consultation fairly easily, and also enables us to monitor how many responses there are and keep physical copies, all of which we're planning on delivering to the Ministry of Justice, possibly on the morning that the consultation concludes. So the first thing you have to do is log into the link which is up there, which you can all see, and has been on various documents that the LCCSA and the CLSA have sent out. It's on Twitter, it's on Facebook, it's easily available. It does take a while to load, and the whole process of responding probably takes in the region of 45 minutes to an hour. I'm not going to insult your intelligence by going through each instruction, such as please read every question carefully, but it's obviously important that you follow the guidance step by step. At the beginning, you'll see that there is a summary of the key concerns, and then there are a series of questions that you need to ask, sorry, you need to answer simply by ticking one of the boxes. Now, there are six questions in the consultation, but when this was set up, there are more questions put in to help the respondees focus on the types of issues that we think we need to bring to the attention of the Ministry of Justice. And these issues were so brilliantly focused on by both Greg and Steve in their respective addresses. And so it's not my intention to spend much time going through how you answer these questions, because it's already been covered. But if you see, for example, the first question is, do you agree that the proposals will ensure that all those accused of a crime will continue to have access to justice and receive quality legal representation? Which is somewhere up there, yes. And you have a range of answers from strongly disagree. You have a range of answers from strongly disagree all the way through to strongly agree. And then you have, and you tick, and underneath is a note, or it could be referred to as a hint, but it's a note. And in the note is the summary of what the CLSA says. Now, when the consultation is actually submitted, amazingly, through some technical wizardry that I know nothing about, the note will not appear in your response. So the Ministry of Justice will not get hundreds, hopefully thousands, of responses with the CLSA notes stroke hints. So we then have a number of questions which you answer in that way, and there isn't any point in me reading them out. It's obvious, you can read them. And under each question you have the CLSA helpful comments, and you just tick the box. And then you'll get to the end of the first page, which is consultation question 4, which says, in addition to the above, do you have any views on the MOJ comments set out in the consultation document? Please provide evidence to support your views. This question must be answered even if you simply indicate you wish to incorporate your replies above. And the whole point is that many people would have dealt with the types of answers that they want to give in consultation question 4 by their responses to the previous questions. So you can simply say, I refer to the above. Where it says, please provide evidence to support your views, well, my view is that in fact that the Ministry of Justice have provided the evidence to support our views in the 3 reports that they have provided. The contents of those reports undermine what they seek to do and support what we say about the consultation. So there's absolutely no reason not to say, well, you've provided the evidence, which I now rely on. So that's the first page, and then we click on next. It takes a little while to load, but I can go on anyway. So, when you get the next page, it deals with Otterburn. And in fact, you can await whilst the hub will actually download the Otterburn report. But there is a summary within the hub of what Otterburn says. I'm not going to refer to that summary now because both Craig and Steve have talked about what Otterburn says. But basically, there's a very short summary, and then there are a series of questions. Again, do you agree, do you disagree, with the five multiple choice answers that are available. And there are a number of questions. For example, do you agree with Otterburn that consortia are unlikely to create the more efficient financial structures required for firms to scale up? Do you agree that there is sufficient time for firms to develop mergers and associations? Do you agree that firms have the management skills to deal with rapid expansion? And where appropriate and where necessary, and where you can't work out what to say, there are the CLSA helpful tips. It's like when you were studying and you went out to get the quick revision guide. This is basically the service that the CLSA provided with their response. And then it goes on. We lost the... Okay. So then we go on. After you have the list of questions on Otterburn, it then has consultation question one, where again it says, in addition to the above, do you have any comments on the Otterburn report, including the observations set out on page 5 to 8 of this report? And again, it's exactly the same scenario. You have to say something, but you can rely on the answers that you've already given, and you can add anything you want. And what is useful to know is that there are other documents that the LCCSA have put out and will put out, which contain, for example, there is a document for non-criminal lawyers and non-lawyers, a guide to what they might want to put in their response, which will go out. And again, you can use these when completing this response. So there's a whole section of questions on Otterburn, which we have drafted. Then there is the consultation question, which is question one out of the six. And then you move on to the next section, which is KPMG. And again, in KPMG, you can download the report. There is a summary of what the KPMG report says, and then there's a series of questions. Do you agree with the assumption that 0.1 profit is a sufficient return to remain viable? Do you agree that work volumes remain constant? Do you agree that latent capacity exists within providers? And so there's a whole series of these questions directly linked to the KPMG assumptions, which effectively address the consultation question that then comes, which is consultation question two. Do you have any comments on the assumptions adopted by KPMG? Please provide evidence to support your views. And yet again, you can just refer to the answers that you've given, and you can add anything you want. So there are a number of questions in relation to KPMG, as well as the consultation question, and it's all multiple choice. Then there is a further consultation, question three, commenting on the analysis produced by KPMG. And once again, prior to that question, there's multiple choice questions which inform in relation to the answer to that question. And again, there is a further question on KPMG, question five, and yet again, you can answer the questions by simply referring to your answers to the questions that we've prepared. I'm probably way ahead, so I'm just going to continue. Then there's reference to the draft report by PA Consulting Group. Now this doesn't figure as part of the consultation. In fact, we asked, both the CLSA and the LCCSA asked the MOJ whether we could disclose this publicly, as it had been referred to in the judicial review. And within hours of us making that request, they published it themselves and said that it wasn't relevant. When it is relevant, it's obviously not relevant because it doesn't say what they wanted to say. And they obviously didn't lean on PA as much as they managed to lean on KPMG. But in any event, we've also referred to the PA Consulting Group report with one question in relation to that. And then finally, the final question, as you know, consultation six, is do you have any other views that the MOJ should consider when deciding on the number of contracts? And again, you can refer to your answers that you've already given and any other comments that you want to make. And then you're asked to give your name, your email address, your firm, and then when you press submit, it goes to the LCCSA and the MOJ at the same time, and you will also get a copy. What's important is that you try and add some comments that are personal to you, even if it's just a couple of sentences. As Greg has said, refer to any experiences that your firm has had. You can only send one response from one email address. So it's important that you get every person in your office to respond from their email addresses. As I've said, we hope to have copies of the vast amount of responses that are submitted. Of course, people can send in responses outside this hub. Letters can be sent in. As I've already said, we've drafted documents to help with that. And of course, that can be done. But this has been set up to ensure that the maximum number of people as possible respond to this consultation. We want the JR, which was a fantastic result. They don't even refer to that in any of their documentation, just simply technical issues that went wrong. And now we want to continue and win the war. And winning the war involves having mass response to this consultation. It's boring, it's drab, it's technical, it's hard to understand. None of us really want to be dealing with this. And none of us envisage that this is what we've been doing as criminal lawyers. But we have to deal with this, we have to respond, and it takes no more than an hour to do so. And I would like every single person in this room to respond and get 10 other people to respond as well. This is the next stage in the battle. We want them to have thousands of responses to consider. We want them to have to spend weeks, if the consultation process is fair, and months going through these responses. We want them to see the overwhelming evidence that everyone responding is opposed to these proposals. Opposed to these proposals which will bring about the destruction of our criminal justice system. Thank you.
Does anyone have any questions for any of our speakers this evening?
Good evening all, Steve Wade from Brighton. I'm wondering whether the panel has considered anti-competitive legislation, such as is frowned on by the European Union, the Financial Conduct Authority, as numerous papers I've been reading this evening and on the train. It seems to me that if a firm has this side of the hall as a duty contract and fails to get that side of its area, the work done in that area will be subsidised by the profitable duty work in this area. In other words, they can only keep going on that side of the wall because they've got this one. Leave aside the question of what firm isn't going to get both contracts, that's another point. What about the anti-competitive element? Any mileage on that, Greg?
Do you like to write a paper on this, Steve?
I'm halfway through it.
Thank you. We'll be really with interest. Don't have any other view. There's a you procurement tendering rules, as I understood them, are that any new entrant should be treated as favourably as an incumbent. That was what we were told in the past tendering rounds. So get back to the problem of criteria in relation to who should be granted a contract. So if you end up in a contractual process with multiple bidders, with multiple business plans, the process of sorting out who should win and who should lose seems to me to be almost impossible in relation, for example, to London. Not quite sure how it applies from Gore, there's only fewer meetings. But I know that the Law Society in Britain, they tell me endlessly to the MOJ saying, how are you going to cope with these problems that arise from water bidding, and never received a reply. So although we get these very strong declarations at the end of the MOJ consultation paper that everything must proceed swiftly and they're very anxious to get on with the process, on the other side they seem to be very unanxious to actually share detailed information about how they're going to deal with the water capacity and contract bids problem. The European dimension, as I said, look forward to your learning papers.
Matt Ferguson, Burgess and Justice Alliance. I just wanted to pick up on the main players here, because I was just looking on the web, and KPMG seemed to be famous for insider dealing and corruption. The sort of people we haven't seen at the police station or the magistrates' court, or that we would ever like you to have met, never seen the work we do, never been to where we work. Whereas the point we can make is that Mr. Otterburn, even though he doesn't look like the most exciting person, meet. He has actually written books on law and firm management and seems to be much closer to the issue. I think we should make that general point. The difficulty seems to me with trying to get people outside of lawyers engaged in this consultation is it's very dense, and I like the way we make the point that it's so dense that it's so difficult to comprehend the documents. Is a point, you know, if you're asking other people to engage with this, which is what we're doing in the Justice Alliance. But it seems we've got that one very good point here, the idea that people are going to give up their solicitor, looking at this from the other point of view, people who've had good work in the past, all those clients that we've got off, who should never be charged, never been in court, who've gone over the last 20, 30 years and had fruitful lives, should be contributing to this consultation to say, I want to be able to choose that solicitor who did that work for me. They should be writing in. We should be approaching all of those people and asking them to write on that basis. And all the people that refer us work, all the community groups, all the campaigns, all the unions, should be writing on the basis that we should have a right to choose our solicitor. Because this is what was at the heart of the campaign when we were outside Parliament at the beginning. And it is under attack, under assumption too, the idea that firms have to give up that client that they know for 20 years who've come back to them with their son, whatever it is. All of those people need to be engaged in this, so I think we can ask them to engage, probably not on the basis of spending an hour working out what KPMG said about their firm's profitability, but certainly on the basis that they want to have good representation. And so I encourage everyone to do that with every client that they've got off who should never have been in the court in the first place.
Yes, thanks. Is there an inherent contradiction between the concession after the first round of consultation that open client choice was important and is restored, and the backdoor attack upon it through the duty solicitor contracting scheme, which would eliminate client choice for many people?
Andrew Pouncer at Goldbeck's Law. Can you update us, please, on what the learned friends are doing?
Well, over to you. We may share this answer without trying to revisit history. The leadership of the bar, from my own personal point of view, probably still cleaning their dagger. The 600 or so members of the bar and loyally fought against the deal that was done behind their and our backs. I think we're still very active, going to respond to this consultation and take the long-term view that our destruction is their destruction. But quite practically what they're doing, I think, is they're probably keeping their heads down in order not to rupture their good relationship with the Minister, but Paul may know more.
I think there has been some communications between us and the leadership of the bar, and they seem to be keen to encourage their members to respond to the consultation. Obviously, one of the consequences of these proposals, if they go through, are that 75% of their supplier base could be wiped out. So it's an absolute no-brainer for them to support this and for them to get involved. And we've had many positive responses from barristers. There are some who've taken the time to come here tonight. They might now want to remain anonymous. But anyway, they're here and they're supporting this event. And we are want as many barristers, as many chambers to respond. And it is our understanding that the Criminal Bar Association have written to all of the chambers, telling them that they should respond, telling them that Andrew's going out the room, I'll let you know the answer afterwards, writing to their individual members and encouraging them to respond. And I think we should all do that. I've written to some of the chambers who I use, and in fact they have members here, saying that I expect all of the barristers to respond, and I expect the chambers to respond, and I expect them to support us, not just for them, but for us. And I would invite everyone here to write to the chambers that they instruct and say exactly the same thing. What has happened in the past is not completely in the past, and we're all obviously scarred about what we perceive to be the betrayal by the leadership of the bar. But that said, we need to go forward. We need to work together on this. We need them to respond, if not for us, but for them. And I hope that they will.
So, ladies and gentlemen, just a few closing remarks. You may be interested to hear that even though the website, the Harbour's, had over 6,000 hits, as of yesterday, only 329 people had responded. So it's really important that after tonight, having now got the information that you need, that you actually go on and do this sooner rather than later. I would hate for the system to crash on Monday or Tuesday because everybody's trying to use it at once. So the sooner we can get on and get our responses completed, the better, please. Because as you know, we need thousands, we don't need 329. The response code is at 11:45 a.m, which is an unusual time, on the 15th of October, which is next Wednesday. So I think we need all our responses in, please, by close on Tuesday, because we need to get those printed off, and we need to get them taken to the MOJ on Wednesday morning. Obviously, they'll still go through electronically. And obviously, the most important message from this evening is the battle will still go on after next Wednesday, and that's not the end. We will continue to meet with the Law Society, who, as you have heard from various speakers this evening, have completely changed their message under the new presidency of Andrew Caplin. We will not forget quickly or deal quietly what has gone on before and how we were treated by the previous officers. But now that the message has changed and it is a positive one, then we will work closely with them and take advantage of their support and their influence that we perhaps do not have. On the table in front of you, you will have hopefully seen a draft letter to send to your local MP. It's time to lobby again, it's time to go and see them, it's time to tell them about the predicament that we find ourselves in, and that all of our colleagues find themselves in, and all of your staff find themselves in, and that's particularly powerful if you live in a marginal seat. So please ensure that you get those set up as soon as you can. And then one final plug, please, which is for the AGM. It's on Monday, the 10th of November. It's going to be at Kettner's. We would love to see you all there, please, to support Jonathan Black as he becomes the new president. He's hoping for a coup. There doesn't seem to be one at the moment. So if you can come along and support him, that would be great. Julian Hayes is going to become our new vice president, and the two of them will take on our struggle next year. For me, it's been an incredibly busy year and an incredibly important year, and we've had a very close group of people working incredibly hard on it. But you can imagine that we're all quite tired and quite exhausted by everything that has gone on. So if there's any fresh blood out there who is up for the fight and you'd like to come and join us, please do let us know. So I look forward to seeing you all at the AGM. Thank you all very much for coming this evening, and thank you all in advance for completing the consultation response online. Thank you.